moving on. This third yoga nidra exercise is a little different from the first two. If you remember, the first one was, I hope you remember, I sense, and the second was I breathe. These are grounding practices where you get in touch with your body's senses, the sensations of your body, and then your breath. And the second one kind of like puts them together where you feel the breath and the sensation of the body. And this is both all of these exercises are what you call formal and portable. Now the formal one means that you do it at a specific time. You set up a place in your house, a little chair or a place where you can lie down, and you do the meditation. What I suggest is that you use one of these, which are about 8 minutes, and then have another 5 minutes where you just continue the meditation with that practice. So you get maybe a 10 or 15 minute meditation. But the portable part of this is where you have the intention to do this all the time. So I do this all the time. So when I'm walking, I don't let my mind go wandering into what about this or what that, or I should have done this or done that, which is the weary mind. I become aware of what my body's doing. So I become aware of the sensations in my body when I walk, in my feet, or the air on my hands. Or I can do the left side of the body and then the right side. Or I may become aware of the breath. Or if I'm watching TV and a commercial comes on, instead of going with the commercial, I use that as a time to bring my attention inward. So I'm constantly working with the present moment of my body and my breath and not letting the mind continue in its conditioned patterns, which is thinking. And if you ever take a dog for a walk on a leash, the dog will smell every fire hydrant and piece of poop on the road, right? So you say, get back, heel, heel. The dog will run off. Well, that's a good metaphor for the mind. If you don't heal the mind's going to run off and get into trouble and smell all kinds of poop. Right. That's what the mind does, and that poop is in time. In other words, it's trapped in time. I should have done this in the past, or this is going to happen in the future, or something's not right now. But it's something, it's in thinking. And so this whole practice is to notice that, and noticing it, and when we notice it, we come back to the present moment, which is body sensing and breath. Now this third exercise takes us to feeling. Now if you'll notice, this is a little different because this one is a little more active. The first one create a ground of your practice. So you always keep doing that. Grounding in your senses, grounding in that. But the second one has something where you can actually work with emotions. It's in two parts. The first part is feeling warmth, heaviness, hardness, softness, lightness, heaviness. And these are sensations or feelings, and you can identify them. And then the practice is to identify opposites: hard, soft, hard, soft, hard, soft. And then just relax in a relaxed way. See if you can hold the two sensations together. And he will say that the mind really can't do this because the mind can only think of one thing at a time. So the mind can't bring these two together because they're opposites. But you could, in a metaphor, if you were writing a poem, you might write a poem that holds both of these together as one. So holding them together requires a lack of effort or an absence of effort, more of a surrender. You see, so this is an exercise to teach us how to learn or to see how not to identify the feelings with a story, but just feel the feeling itself. Then he moves to the second part, and he suggests that you call up a particular emotion that you're working with, that you would like to work with. For instance, you're angry at your neighbor. The neighbor did something that's created a worry or a vortex. Draw a little picture of a tornado here. It's a good example of a vortex, or if you want to use a tornado, use the pull the plug in the pull the plug in the tub and watch the vortex form. The vortex is formed by two opposites chasing each other. Okay? In other words, you don't get this vortex unless you get somebody chasing somebody. So you get a positive and a negative, or two energies that are not compatible. They can't become one, and they're chasing each other trying to become one. But they can't, so they create a vortex. And without any checks, it gets bigger. So a worry can become a panic. So a worry might be a little breeze in the yard that twirls the leaves, you know, in the fall, and get a little vortex, and a little wind comes, whoosh, you know. All right, well, that's a worry when it's first born. Unless it's checked, it becomes a panic. I don't know if for some reason this came up, but there's a mythological figure in Texas called Pecos Bill. But he's got a story to him, but he rides the tornado. Okay, so Pecos Bill rides the tornado. And then I thought of remember the movie How I Learned to Love the Bomb? Remember that? It was in the 60s. I think that was Dr. the name Strange, of it.
Dr.
Strangelove. Or How I Learned to Love the Bomb. But basically it was about a vortex, which was the Cold War and the nuclear annihilation being at any moment type of thing, you know. So this was a vortex of, the Cold War was a vortex of America and Russia going like this, and it was increasing because neither one could become the other one. They were both equal, they kept adding equal military might, so they were always equal, but they couldn't become one. They were two. That creates a vortex, and unless checked, it will just finally explode into violence, which we see in the news all the time when domestic, particularly in family or domestic violence, where it goes along, boom, 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 and the next thing you know, somebody pulls out a gun and shoots the other person because they can't tolerate, or they have no way to contain the vortex. So basically what we're working with here, I'm drawing a little connections here so we can kind of get a big picture, is that we're trying to understand our minds as vortex creating systems, like the weather. Our mind is like the weather, it creates vortexes. So what do you do with a vortex? Or with what you could call a vicious cycle. Okay, so a vortex is a cycle. It's vicious because it's painful and it becomes self-destructive. And that little thing I handed out to you, this is kind of dated, and maybe not dated, but this goes back to the 60s when transcendental meditation was popular. Y'all remember that? And that was kind of like the first scientifically recognized meditation system from the East that the secular society could adopt, because it didn't come dressed in Hindu clothes with beads and sandals and chants and all of the other spiritual and religious trappings that meditation came with. You know, it was just very scientific, and it was measurable in the lab, and it was called the fight or flight response, so that when you get an attack, like a telemarketer, getting back to that, that can create a flight or fight response. You see, so the fight would be, I'm fed up, and you take the phone and smash it. That would be a vortex. See, that would be a little bit, irritating, I'm irritated, I'm irritated, I'm irritated with being irritated, I'm irritated with being irritated, I'm irritated, pow! You know, that would be explode, you know. And it could all start with a tiny little telemarketer call. That's what they say. If a butterfly flaps in Brazil, it can cause a tornado in Oklahoma. You know, it's that kind of... So this whole practice is to notice the vortex instead of letting it consume us. Because if we're not outside of the vortex, we are inside of the vortex. See, so when I notice the vortex, in order for me to notice it, I have to be outside of it. See, this is a very important idea, is that this idea of noticing. So when he says, be aware of the warm feeling somewhere in your body, he's saying notice it. But he's saying don't think about it. Just notice it. Noticing is non-judgmental. Noticing has no story with it. Now, so in this practice, you start with sensations that don't have any story. If I feel a warmth in my body somewhere, and then I feel a coolness maybe from the air conditioning on my arm, and then I feel a warmth somewhere, there's no story with that. It's not caused by anybody. Nobody's doing it to me. My mother didn't do this to me, or my neighbor. You know, there's no story. But as soon as you go to the emotions, now we're getting into the heavy stuff. So now if I go to the anger, this vortex that my anger, see how this creates a vortex. My neighbor did something to make me angry, but I'm a Christian. So I'm supposed to love my neighbor, but I don't. But I'm supposed to. Now that creates a vortex. I should, but I can't. I can't do it. I can try, I can repress, I can pretend, you see, but the feeling is there. I don't feel it, but I should feel it. Now here we got, no, but I have to be one. You see, okay, so this creates, as soon as I got my feeling over here, I'm angry, you know, I don't like my neighbor, but I should like my neighbor. So I am two. See, now I have split myself, I'm two. I should be good, I don't feel good. Bam. But the imperative, the commandment of life is, I must be, there shall be one. So I have to be one, even in the Bible. When the idea of the Jewish God in the Bible is there is only one God. Let there be one. Not two gods, not many, one. Well, this is the same with us, our sense of self. There is only one me. If there's two, I'm schizophrenic. You see, I split personality. This is a lot of pathology. People will, unable to solve this ambiguity, they'll split into two personalities or more. Or they become a hypocrite, where the public face is good, but the backside face is the opposite. Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, yeah.
a person is unable to reconcile conflict. I mean, you can't say I'm conflicted or I'm...
Yes, yeah. Yeah, so what, yeah, what we're, I guess what we're digging into here, this is my shovel. So what we're digging into is to recognizing the many faces of the, what we're calling the vicious cycle of the vortex. No. So it can be with the telemarketer ringing and disrupting my class, you see. Do I get, I may smile, telemarketer, but I may be really irritated. So there's a disjunct between my thinking and feeling. You see, we can't control feelings. I mean, you can't make yourself like something. You know, kids get through this, eat the broccoli. You're supposed to like it. I don't like the broccoli. So the kid will say that, I don't like it, I don't feel it. The parent says, well, you should feel it. Right? Now that creates, that splits the kid right there. He's already, my parents, God, say I should like it, but I don't like it. You know, so now I'm going to repress, I'm going to have a repression, I'm going to have to do something to get rid of this split, you see. So there are a lot of strategies that people will go through, and in the Bible, hypocrisy is one of them. A hypocrite who will do one thing and say another, basically. So, but he doesn't know it. If he does, or either he doesn't know it, or he knows it and won't admit it. But the hypocrite, you see, then, is a split. So this thing goes way back. But what we're dealing is not these big issues. We're dealing with the very simple ones. It is like, what do I do when the telemarketer calls? So we have to work with the world we've got. So this yoga nidra practice today, basically, when he talks about getting to the emotions, now what he's saying there is, okay, so you've got this anger with the neighbor that's creating a little vicious cycle, a vortex. You're supposed to like him, but you don't. How do you work with that in your dharma practice? Again, we're getting back to this idea of dharma, which basically is how do you apply this teaching to my everyday life? How do I apply it? So this yoga nidra is basically an application on how to apply this teaching or understanding to my everyday mind. So what you do with this then is that what he suggests you do is that you're sitting there, okay, so I'm going to imagine the anger I feel about the neighbor. You remember an incident when the neighbor did something, and you call up the anger, and then you disconnect it from the story of the neighbor, what he did to you and all that, and you just become curious about the sensation of the anger. I'm curious about this feeling or this emotion. And then you imagine a situation where you feel, imagine at the beach. Now you're feeling, you find some peaceful. And then you go back to the anger, just the feeling, boom, then back to the peaceful feeling. And now you're doing your own vortex. We'll call it the virtuous.
V-I-R-T-U-O-U-E-S.
See, I've got a blank now. Right? Virtuous. Virtuous.
U-S.
Okay, there we go. Okay, virtuous cycle. Okay? So a virtuous cycle working with the pain that I flee from. So if the anger is painful, we don't like anger, irritation or whatever, we get the anger or the irritation because in our everyday mind, somebody's causing it. If the telemarketer interrupts my class, the telemarketer is doing it to me. You know, so I get angry at the telemarketer, but he's not being affected by it. He doesn't care. I got the anger. I got the irritation, and I can't get rid of it because I put that irritation in a vortex. So I need to intervene. So I've got to find some way to intervene and break up the vortex. You'll notice about that if you look at the vortex in a tub or any little vortex. If you stick your hand in it and you interrupt the energy, it dissipates. You see, so you have to, this is what you call intervention with addiction people. Basically what that is they go in there and they try to intervene and break up the vortex of addiction. Addiction is a solution to a vortex. In other words, people will get into a vortex of pain and they'll take a drug as a strategy to get out of the pain of the vortex. But it just kicks the can down the road, so they have to keep doing it again and again and again. So they don't solve anything. But basically, that is drugs or alcohol is a strategy to get out of the pain of a vortex. So what we're the problem with the vortex or the stress cycle is that you can't get out of it by effort, because the effort is just one half of it. Effort can't change feelings. I mean, that's pretty obvious to everybody. You can't make your feelings do what you think they should do. So the feelings are kind of like, they're very rebellious. They never do what you want them to do. And you can't, so they're like teenagers. You can't make them do what you want. You can't make feelings do what they want to do. So all the effort in the world is not going to make a feeling change. So there has to be another way of working with this other than personal willpower, because personal willpower is part of the vortex. In other words, everything I know is part of, when a vortex rises, everything is in it. You know, me, my feelings, my dreams, everything. I'm consumed, but I am in it. The only thing that is not in the vortex is noticing. So if I notice that, and I can give it a name, the power of the name, if I can say, oh, there's a vortex, or give it your own name, it's a tornado, or it's the vicious cycle, oh, there's the vicious cycle. If you name it, you're outside of it. You can't name something, I can't name this unless I'm outside of it and I can see it. I'll call this a marker. But I have to know it. I have to see it. So I have to be here. So if I can notice the vortex, then I can name it and say, okay, there's that vicious cycle again. So now what do I do? You see, okay, so that's the first step. If you remember the Four Noble Truths, Buddha, the first one is there is suffering or the vortex. if you remember, our old friend Dukkha, okay, our old friend Dukkha in the Sanskrit means suffering, disappointment, any negativity, but it also means duality. So a vortex is duality of two incompatible aspects of the psyche that want to be one but can't be. So the dukkha means that when I have a worry, stress, worry, it's painful, but everything I do just makes it go more. So I can't think my way out of worry, which is the feeling. So you see what I mean? So I got thought here, thinking, and feeling. So if I were to split these two, I would say worry is the story. In other words, what's going to happen, what could happen, what might happen, what I should have done but didn't, what I should do in the future. Worry. There's a story to it. Thinking. But the worry is also feeling. You see, it's a feeling, a sensation. A sensation attached to a story. I just hope you can get a little grasp of this, how these two interact. So I'm thinking, I got a story is thought. I'm thinking about my neighbor, the anger comes up, the feeling comes up, okay? The neighbor, I believe, the neighbor is causing this feeling that is painful because it splits me. When we don't feel split, we feel at peace. I'm at home. Ah. And then a telemarketer calls, metaphor, something intervenes and disturbs my peace, and now I've got a story about what it was that disturbed my peace, and it shouldn't have happened because I don't feel at home now, I don't feel at one, and that guy or that thing or that is the blame. So now I gotta get back to peace again, but I'm split because the effort of Eckhart Tolle says, if you can leave something, leave it. If you can fix it, fix it. But if you can do neither, accept it. Anything else is madness. Well, the madness would be worry. If you can leave something, just leave it. If you can fix it, fix it. If you can't do that, accept it. Now, acceptance means noticing it. See, so acceptance means I'm going to work with it. I can work with this. So get the feeling with. So what is he? How does he say to work with it? If you want to. So if you've got a specific thing, like an anger, the neighbor just pissed me off, and I got this thing going on. So I sit down and do my yoga nidra, and I call up the situation, and I feel the emotion of the anger. Okay, there's the vicious cycle. Now I just forget about the story and put my attention on the feeling, just like I did in the feel the warm spot, feel the heavy spot, feel the cool, feel the light. Now I'm feeling the anger. Then he says, well, where is it in your body? Is it like here in the gut, or somewhere? Where is it? Be curious about it. Where? Oh, there it is. And then you come up with an opposite. Okay, so now you come up with a negative, and then you come up with a positive. All right? and go back and forth, play with it. It's kind of like a kid with a toy. You're playing with this feeling. Isn't this interesting? And then you just relax and see if you can just can you just kind of like hold them both together? Not struggling there. See what happens. And what happens is that when you disengage the feeling from the story, you become one again. You become just the feeling, and there is nothing to hold the feeling because the feeling was held in place by the story. So if you can let go of the story that the neighbor did it to me and just hold the feeling, you'll discover that the feeling changes, because here's another teaching that goes with this, impermanent. Everything is impermanent, including our feelings. But what makes the feeling permanent is that we lock it into a story, a lockbox, and the story is in the past, but the feeling is in the present moment, and I've anchored the feeling to the past, and I can't go back in the past to fix it. So now I have made this anger permanent, and I create a vicious cycle trying to get out of this anger and become peaceful again. But I can't do it because the cause of the feeling has been misplaced and put in the story. So I put the cause of the feeling in the story, and the story is in the past, and I can't change it. This is a lockbox I can't open. There's no way I can get out of it, except medication, or as we see in this thing here, stress disorders. So these little vortexes, you see, lead, because the body and mind influence each other. If my mind has a vortex, the body's going to get one too. Yeah, it could be diabetes, it could be all kinds of stress disorders that come about because of the worry mind. And if you look at our culture, the whole culture is in this. The American culture is a worry culture. And we keep buying stuff and drinking stuff and eating entertainment in order to get out of the worry. So everybody's selling us stuff to get out of the worry. You'll feel better if you have a new car. You know, or whatever. You know, so this whole worry, dissatisfaction with myself, creates the whole industry. So I'm hoping that, you know, that you can, that we, as we work with this, that you get a visual hold on this, because you can't get a grab of it if it's just thought. Because thought is, I remember when I thought I was going to be a minister back in 1969. I went to the theological seminary in Richmond, but kind of as a dark horse. I mean, I didn't have any church or anything. I just wanted to be a minister. So I said, "Here I am," you know. So I showed up in the middle of the year. They had accepted me, but then. When I got there and they took a serious look at me, they threw me out. So, but anyway, I did get into the Hebrew class for a while, and I discovered that Hebrew was very hard to learn because it was not a Latin language. So you didn't have the grammar, you didn't have the any context in which to hang it on. It was just like sounds, just words, you know. And so I was finding it very difficult to, because it was all memorization. I had no structure, I had no pattern, I had no hold, nothing to put all the parts in. And we all experience that. This is why computers, when you first get a computer, you're particularly if you're older, because you have no context in which to understand all the different little things you do. When my mother was, she got a computer when she was 100. And talk about, I was her tech support. Now that was fun. Because she would do things that I had no idea where she was. And then she would get stuck and she would just start punching buttons. So when we're working with the form, the mind as an operating system, just like the operating system on the computer, you can't see the operating system. You only see what it does, right? You just see what it does. There's no operating system as a thing. It's a system of operations that all fit together and do things. So the mind is an operating system that does stuff, and we live in the mind as an I. Okay? So I live in my mind, and my mind does stuff that I have no control over or idea what it's doing, in the same way my mother had no idea what the computer was doing. She had no overall understanding or picture of the system. So if you can get a picture of something, then all the information that you get fits into the picture. It's like you get a map and then you fill in the towns and you fill in the rivers and you fill in the trees and you fill everything in, but there's a basic abstract outline that has no content, but it has a system or a form in which the content relates to each other. So what we're doing here is trying to get an understanding of how our minds work, and a picture helps, because if you have a picture, a metaphor, this is a metaphor, so this is an Ouroboros. It's an ancient metaphor of the snake eating its own tail, and it's a metaphor for the vicious cycle or the vortex or the wary cycle of the mind. So if you notice your mind's getting into a vortex, you can come up with the picture of the dragon eating its tail. There it is. See? So that's the first noble truth of the Four Noble Truths, of which is the whole Dharma is based on these four truths. The first one is, I notice the suffering. There it is. It's bigger, it's more than that, but we're just looking at the application personally. So there it is. There is a vicious cycle. Now the next thing is, well, let's take a look at this. On the on that little paper I handed out, you've got a picture of the vicious cycle there, which starts off with an irritation or some little attack, and it gets into a flight or fight response, and then you get into the body, and the body begins to have reactions, and you get stress disorders, and around we go. So then this says, well, there are four ways listed here that you can break into this cycle, and the four ways are be mindfulness or practice rain, and I'll get into that in a minute. Conscious breathing, focus on the inner body, that would be the yoga nidra. Allow grievances means to notice them without judgment. And then a little yoga will help stretch and release the tension, which works with the tension in the body. This is not a yoga class, so we're working with the tension in the mind that creates the tension in the body. So we're kind of like going back to the operating system instead of working with the effects of the worry, which is in the body. Either way, you can get to the mind, but like this is this is why I switched from yoga to, let's just talk about ring. Okay, so you notice that you got a vicious cycle going, you got a little tornado starting, you got a little worry cycle going, maybe an old one, maybe a new one. I noticed it, then I'm going to practice rain. Okay, so the first, everybody knows what rain means. Rain, if you're getting married and it rains, it's auspicious, because they say. You know, it's auspicious, you get rain is grace, you're getting grace. You know, there, you know, the drought is over, the plants will grow, the rain is falling. Oh yes, good signs. So rain means, first, recognize. Or notice. Okay. So the first step is you notice the vortex. Then A is let me see. Allow.
We need to move that.
This is in the way, I'm sorry. You get it. Send you to a chiropractor after you leave here.
Because
you okay?
I'm okay,
yeah. Okay, so A, rain, is allow. All right, so you allow the vortex to feel it to be there. You allow it to be there. Instead of that shouldn't be here, getting pissed off and everything, well, you allow it. Okay, it's here. And then this is inquire, okay, or I'm curious. You can't be curious about something unless you allow it to be there. And you can't be curious about it if you're judging it and saying it shouldn't be here or it's wrong or it could be better or whatever. It is just what it is. So you inquire, you're curious, and this is not don't identify with no or not identify.
Can you elaborate?
Yes. So going back, we're going to be the practice of rain, basically.
You mean not identify?
Yeah, okay. Yes, not identify means that this is not me. Remember, going back to notice, if I notice something, the noticer is not the noticed. If I judge it, and say, this shouldn't be here, I gotta fix it, something's wrong with me, something's wrong with the person, you know. There's the cause to it. I try to fix it or leave it, you see. I got the sticky, it's like the old, you know, you got the fly paper on your hand, you can't get rid of it, you see. And the more you get stuck on it, then the next thing you know, you're all stuck up on it, you see. So this kind of like non-identification, just noticing it means you're not, you can't notice something if you're identified with it. You see, because noticing means unconditional awareness or noticing without attachment, without a flight or fight response. I gotta beat it down or I gotta get away from it. No. So allow, then you allow it to be there. In other words, now you're getting back into yoga nidra in the first part, which he says, I welcome all perceptions as a guide to my essential ground of being. So now basically allowing is welcoming the anger or the irritation or the feeling, the negativity, to be there. And if I can do these three, I've already gotten kind of like to not identify with, you know, because this is kind of like the thing that drives the other two, you know, because if you're identified with it, you can't do the first three.
Like, I'm not anger, I'm not
Well, you don't really say, you don't say anything. Because see, this, because in other words, noticing is not thinking. Noticing is just, if a mouse runs across the floor, I may notice it and just go on talking to you. Or I could say, oh my God, a mouse. You see. Then right then, I've identified, you know, now the mouse, I've identified with it. I could notice the mouse. We do this all the time. I mean, you're sitting around and you notice a bird fly by. But you don't get out a gun and shoot it. You see, you know, you just notice something. You notice, I can say, you know, notice the red water hole. You know, so we could go through the room and notice things without having a story attached to it, or that shouldn't be here, or I wonder where he got that. If I said, notice this, immediately people will say, well, that's it. Where did you get that? I like that. But then I have one at home that's not quite, that's a little bit better than that. Well, I have one that's blue. And do they have other colors? And how much did it cost? Now, we could spend the rest of the hour, you see, spinning a story on this. But the noticing of it is prior to my identification with it and then my putting my own name on it, you see. Now, I want to name this thing and make it mine. So I either want to say it's no good or I want one. So I'm either going to run from it or possess it. Yeah.
Well, do you think that most people do get involved in more than one of these practices, or a difficult person might recognize the problem, or recognize the feeling or whatever, and then allow it, investigate it, but identify with it? In other words,
most people don't do this, any of this.
All right.
Not here.
No.
But it could be that a lot of people do three of these and then.
Well, Christianity, well, religions get into this. I mean, that's the part, one of the religions. So what does religion say about this? Forgive or accept, don't judge. But these are commandments. I can't do it. I still feel like the son of a bitch needs to be hit, you see. You see what I mean? I still feel it. But see, that puts me back here. I got to believe this. I got to do this because I'm a good Christian. This is what Jesus did. I got to do that, but I don't feel it. So now that creates another bite, you see. I mean, that just creates, now I'm worried about myself because I'm not a good Christian. You know, so now I got to try harder. And the more I try, the more I feel, the more I feel myself because I can't do it. You see? So obviously, there's nothing wrong with this particular teaching, but the problem is that we're not taught how to make it work. So belief just stays on this side. You see, if I believe something, I'm still in the thought realm of I as a thinker, a personality, a person, a thought, and my feelings over here, you see, are just aliens. They just don't want to do anything. You see, so this is a split in our culture between mind and body. We're taught from, particularly in fundamentalist, not all of Christianity, but in major religions, yoga too, there is a separation between mind and body. So you get mind is spirit, and the body is flesh. Okay, so the whole thrust is to get more spirit. God is here. Devil is here. Okay? So the whole teaching goes in that direction, away from this. So you gotta control it, you gotta repress it, you gotta spank it, you gotta put it in jail, you gotta punish it, you gotta do something to control feelings, make them fit into what they should be, because then I can be one. See? So all of these efforts, if they don't include feelings, just continue to separate me from myself. Or you could also say nature. Okay? On this side you have a leaning towards control, and over here you have chaos. Control, chaos. You know, so this, so basically what this Dharma teaching is doing, he says, okay, we have to notice that this is not working. We're not thinking about in terms of big religious problems and the world and humanity and all of the big external things. I'm talking about just can I handle aging? You know, can I handle arthritis? And can I handle the body falling apart? Can I handle the wrinkles in the mirror? Can I handle my neighbors and my family dying? You know, can I handle the stress that particularly in our life cycle here is created by aging? That little talk I handed out to you, did everybody get one? By Rodney Stewart. Just a really great talk I don't think you got one, did you? You came in. What have you got?
That's easy. I gave him a second.
Oh, you got one. Yeah. Okay. This what I loved about this talk, I hope you listened to it, is that he brings aging into the Dharma practice. This was there were 18 talks. This was the last two in a series that he did. It's at seattleinsight.org, Rodney Smith, so you can go to this website and log into any of his talks. He's been doing these talks for the last 10 years. But this particular one, what he does is he ties the stress and worry of aging into the practice. So if we were to practice, let's face it, a lot of the factors in aging create vicious cycles of worry. You know, my body's not doing what it used to do. I've got these illnesses, all the things that are associated with aging just creates a whole new bucket full of stress that youth doesn't deal with because they're going to live forever. Yeah?
I have a question. So this was very helpful, that how to deal with the vortex, right?
Yeah.
Now the question is, if your friend or something, if they are identifying with stuff and they pull you into that, how do you stop that?
Someone else puts you into a worry?
So they have the tendency to identify with stuff.
Right.
Right? So you taught us, okay, be aware and don't identify with stuff. But you know, you don't have control over others. And if they identify with stuff constantly, then how do you break that cycle of you getting pulled into it?
Family.
Okay, all right, so you're talking, all right, so good question. So you're talking about families that create these tornadoes every time you win, and most people, it's not just family, everybody we know does this, people, what do people talk about is that their most recent irritation, their most recent grievance, whether it's or a problem, a physical, everybody's talking about the doctor, what's going on, and somebody just went to the doctor, you know, yada, yada, yada. So we just spend all of our energy in drinking this worry about aging and why it shouldn't be. The big problem if you have aging is it just shouldn't happen. This shouldn't be, you know. So now I got the, I'm in direct confrontation with what is. So if you're in a family situation that you go walk in the door, and we all know this, you walk in the door and you sit down at the table, and you were feeling great, you were at peace, you were at home in yourself, and you sit down, and the next thing you know, you're in this kind of a stew, and it's circular, you know it's not going anywhere because it's the same one you were in the last time you were there, except the content's different. So you become interested in other words, so if you want to practice rain, you notice that there it is again. There's this stress cycle, okay? And so then you become really curious about how it sucks you in, the feelings you're having. It's okay to have the feelings. In other words, you allow the feelings, your irritations you're having, the, oh my God, I'm stuck in it again, or this shouldn't be, or whatever you're feeling, you allow that, you're curious about it, and you by noticing it, you know that you're not it. This, you're in it, but you're not it. So you use the world that's given, and now you're talking about, this is given, I walk in here, I didn't ask for it, it's given to me, I'm going to work with this. So now you welcome it as an opportunity to free yourself from the worry mind. You see? So you're using, it's kind of like if you're stuck in an ice cave and the only way, and you have no tools but a frozen turd, so you take that and you dig your way out, well then you throw it and you leave it. No, so you're using the turds of the vicious cycle to dig your way out of it, okay? But this means that you have to allow it, and you even welcome it. You say, oh boy, this is a chance to really look at this. You see, this, you know, so it flips the whole game. Instead of running from it, being angry with it, hitting yourself, hitting them, I'm stuck in it again, you know, the whole thing, you just drop that and embrace it.
Conflict in some ways. This becomes a point of conflict because, you know, you don't have control over your family members. And they may have the negative tendencies, and you are like, I don't want to spend a minute of my time in negativity. Right. So what I'm feeling is this is perfectly fine in managing your own self, but then we need to bring the conflict management thing. Well, I would, let me stop you right there. Let's drop the word management.
Control, because then you're getting back over here. You see, in other words, they're feelings and your feelings, and you want to manage it. I want to manage my way out of this. That's not what this practice is. This is not doing anything. This is a non-violent practice. Because violence means I'm going to manage it. I'm going to control it, fix it, leave it, do something to it. Effort, I've got to do something to manage it, to make it better. This is hands-off. I'm not going to do anything. I'm going to allow aging to be here. I'm going to allow this family to be here in their misery or whatever. They're stuck in, you see, I'm going to allow it. And what happens when you do this, you allow a creative response to happen that you didn't know you could do or would do. You don't know what you're going to do. You see, because on the other side of control, there's this chaos, you see. So we believe that if I don't control my mind, chaos will come up. I mean, I could get angry, I could hit somebody, I could hit myself, I could do something that I would regret, I would say something. I'm afraid of myself, so I better control. Right? But if I relax the control, this, see, we have no idea what faith is. We think faith is belief. I believe in God, I believe in the commandments, I believe Jesus will save me, I believe, you know, all these things, you see. I believe in the commandments, all that. But we get it confused with faith. Now, faith, in this context here, is the faith that if I relax control, something creative will happen. If I relax control over my mind and the minds of other people and my family, if I just notice I'm stuck, I notice there's stress, I allow it, I'm curious, I watch it, I follow it, but at the same time, I'm in it. It doesn't mean I pull back and sit over in the corner and watch them squabble. It means I'm in it. I'm swimming in the family with them, and they're yelling at me, and I'm all that. I'm in it. But at the same time, there is an awakened noticer that is just tracking all of this. Isn't this interesting? When I said that, they said this. When they did this, I felt that. I'm feeling it right now, what they said. It's okay. I'm feeling that really, that woman really hurt me. She said something that was really nasty. I can feel it right in my gut, and I allow it. I allow the feeling. I don't lash back and say something. You see? If I do, I notice that. You see, so I'm constantly curious about my operating system as it's operating. And the only way to be aware of our operating system as it's operating is when it's getting into trouble. If I'm sitting at home, you know, on the back porch, I'm fine, you know. But then the neighbor comes over and says something to me, and now I'm all in a snit, you see. That's where the practice is. It's not when everything's fine. It's when everything isn't fine. So we kind of like, it really flips our whole way of saying, damn, this aging is great. not in the sense that, you know, if I would choose it, you know, it's not like that, give me a smorgasbord of things and I'll choose aging. But it means it's what is. This is what is, right? So aging is now. And faith comes in, basically, when faith knows, it doesn't believe, faith knows that it's okay, I'll be okay if I relax control and trying to get out of it. And so Rodney Smith ends this talk, I hope you listen to it, he says the only way to get out of aging is to embrace it. The only way to get out of the pain of aging is to embrace it. Welcome it fully. The whole catastrophe. the whole works, you know, because it is. It can't be other than what it is, you see. Yeah.
Well, you take that a step farther and it's accepting death.
Yeah.
It's really, you know, and we always talk around death.
Yeah.
Aging is sort of just another way of making death sound less.
I'm glad you brought that in. So let's get, I put this up here, birth, aging, and death, okay? So in the Buddha, they're getting back to the legend of the Buddha, which is just basically a picture or a story that we can use to work on ourselves. So the story of the Buddha is when he leaves his pleasure palace, which was a palace where no death happened, youth, immortality, everything's fine. You see, when he left that and went into the village, he had an existential encounter with existence. And he saw sickness, old age, and death. And it was like when the doctor calls and says, you've got cancer. I mean, bam, you know. Suddenly you're encountering the impermanence of existence, that all forms die. Mental forms and physical, all forms die, impermanent. There's no place to hang on to. So he sees that, and then he sees a monk or a renunciate, somebody who has died to the world, and he says, that's my path. I want to find release from old age, sickness, and death. So he chose dying. You see, if we separate and our culture does this, so we're really going against the stream. Our culture separates life from death. So life is good, death is bad. So we got all the medical industry to remove death as best we can. If somebody dies on the street, the ER comes and sweeps them up, puts a bag over them. You don't see any bodies lying around. You know, you go to a funeral home, and they dress the corpse up so it looks better than it did when it was alive. So, grandma looks better now. So, look, death is like death didn't happen. So this whole movement is away from death towards life, which is future. And death is now. You see, so death, the realization of impermanence, is always now. Death doesn't happen in the past. When death happens, it always happens now. When my house burns down, it didn't burn down in the past, it happens now. When my dog dies, the dog dies now. After the dog dies, now it was in the past. But when death is here, it's always now. So death kind of like cracks open the egg of now and reveals its guts, its truth, you see, which is life. So I was watching a YouTube this morning. I use them kind of like, as I said, like video metaphors. So there was a little video of a pride of lions, a couple of males and a bunch of female lions, and they were eating a big buffalo. And one of the lions got him to sniff with the other one. So they got into a little fight. The females, they started fighting each other, and the males went over and tried to stop them, and get them, and they were just having a squabble. And the buffalo looks up, and he just gets up, and, "No, they don't want to eat me today." Walks off, and the lions leave. And it was so funny because the buffalo had accepted death. The buffalo accepted. It wasn't struggling and fighting. It was just lying there. "Okay, you got me down. Go ahead, eat me." And the lions have to eat. Okay? So then when the lions got distracted because they created some kind of a vicious circle, you report there. He just got up and he didn't run like, "Oh my God, I'm free." He just walked on like, "Oh well." So animal nature knows that life and death is one. You can't have one without the other. Everything is always, as soon as we're born, we're dying. Everything is dying, except we can't see it because it's slow motion. You see, but everything is crumbling and everything is being born. Everything is being born and everything is dying at the same moment, you see. So it's really one, but the operating system of our mind splits it into two, and now we have to control. See, the body dies, the flesh dies, nature dies, the devil, well, I would believe him all, but we'll see that religion says, "Well, if God is so good, why is there evil? Will the devil do?" It keeps God on the good side. So anyway, but yeah, this whole thing here, you see, is death. Decay gets messy, stinks, it's falling apart, it's got warts, it's flesh and blood, it's not an image, it's real. You see, in our culture, we see this all the time, that image is photoshopped. In other words, the model is not a real woman, she's a doll. You see, so there's this big urge in our society to get real, get unplugged, to be unscripted, be real. Don't be manufactured, plastic, scripted, programmed. He said, we don't, it's everywhere, this whole life. So basically, it's trying to get life and death back together. Because when they're together, it's very, very real, you see. That's what we love poetry about the rose, because the rose's beauty is because it's dying. It's fragile. Otherwise, you get a plastic rose. It won't die, but we know that it isn't the same as a real rose. You know? So the beauty of life is in its death. The beauty in life is that it ages. If it didn't age, we'd be like in a Seinfeld skit, sitting at the end of the skit in a jail, you know, just saying the same things over and again, you know, for eternity. How boring heaven would be if it was just sitting there repeating the past, you see. So this faith, you see, really, to me, the faith is something that activates, in us when we're willing to take a chance on letting go of trying to control the operating system to see what happens. See, so we don't know what will happen if I let down control, if I stop trying to get out of the worry. You know, what would happen if I accept? I don't know. But something in me tells me that it would be okay. So to me, that is faith. It's that fundamental, I'm okay, the world is okay, if I don't try to fix it or avoid it. But we really have to play with it, because the inertia of this operating system is so strong because it's held in place by our culture. Yeah.
What I find interesting about faith is that most people who talk about it say they know the answer, they know exactly what's going to happen,
right,
and all that. And to me, though, faith is more related to not knowing, or as you said, just accepting,
yeah,
that what is going to be is going to be.
Yeah.
That's true faith, I think.
Yeah.
But you know, in our world, that group that has and knows the answer say that the ones that don't have no faith.
Right. Well, see, that's an avoidance. Glad you brought that up, because getting back on this side here, on the thinking side, we want the mind side, we want certainty.
Yeah.
Over here is uncertainty, right? And so uncertainty is like death. You know, death is scary because it's uncertain. You can't plan it, you can't go there and figure it out, you know. It's uncertain. So this practice basically is allowing uncertainty, which is about allowing death to happen. Death in that meaning would be uncertain. I don't know what's there. I don't know what will happen to me if I relax my effort to control me. It doesn't mean you don't have plans or anything. I'm talking about the OS of the mind, the operating system here. Is there anything other than the operating system, or is it just all conditioned habits of my mind, you see? Is there anything other than my mind's operating system? If you have a computer, yeah, there's the hard drive. So the operating system operates on the hard drive, but the hard drive doesn't do anything. It just gives power to the operating system. If you want to do something, you have to have an operating system. So if you want to do something, you have to have an operating mind, but the power of the mind doesn't come from the operating system. It comes from something that's unknown. So when you notice this, or you become aware that noticing would be like the hard drive noticing the operating system. In other words, the noticing is awareness that's not part of the operating system, because it is aware of the operating system. And the operating system can't be seen as a system, it can only be seen in what it does. So if my mind is doing a worry vortex, that's the program in the operating system. But noticing it, you see, is not the program. You see, this we do this all the time. If you well, I jump around. I'm sorry. But you know, if somebody's a mechanic, they have an overall operating system idea of the car, and if some carburetor or something goes wrong, they can go right to it because the reference is the whole car. They don't look, you know, get, if you're not a mechanic, you look at it, it's just a bunch of parts. It's when my mother looked at the computer, you know, it's just a bunch of buttons and stuff. And there was no, in her mind, there was no paradigm or manual or outline of how the whole the system worked, you see. So if you have an outline of how the system works, that which is aware of the outline is you. Or you could call it self. Or you could call it God. Or you could call it Christ. Or you could call it Buddha nature. Or you could call it wisdom. You see, it's fill in the blank because it's unknown. There's nobody there. The person that's there is the one that's in the opposite, is the me stuck in the me that's stuck in the worry is the person. But the noticing of the system is an unknown. And so people will fill in the blank so they can get a handle on it and call it God, self, Christ, Buddha nature, Allah, go down the list.
So all those words are referring to something that is unknown.
Yeah. Yeah, so the name is... So, you know, so we want to know God, so we name him, and now I know it, you know. But God, the blank, is really death, is the same as death. If it's nobody there, there's nothing there. You can't go there, there's nothing there. It's like death. So I don't want to go there, because then I won't know who I am, you see. Come on in here. Guess we can stop here. Yeah, unless somebody had any questions or anything? Are you stuck on something? What? There are some, Sam brought some little cakes, if anybody would like to get something.
Yeah.